श्रीमद सद्गुरु सरकार की श्यावर रामचंद्र की। प्यारी प्यारी राधा रानी की जय। गीता माता की जय। Devotees of Sotra's eyes, clasping hands together in humble salutations. Focus your mind on the Lord, the middle of the street of the Supreme Lord, the spiritual master. Seek in their guidance, blessings and protection. Ajnana ki nirandhasya jnana janashalakaya चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। यस्यैकनिःश्वसितकालं धावनं जीवन्ति लोम विलजा जगदन्दनाथ। विष्णुर्महास इह यस्य कला विशेषो गोविन्दमारि पुरुषं तमहं भजामि। नमः कमलनाथ भाय, नमः कमलमालिने, नमः कमलपादाय। नमस्ते कमलेक्षं यो ब्रह्मानं विदधाति पूर्वं योगैर्विनाश्च प्रभिनोति तस्मै तद्गुणहदेवमात्मबुद्धिप्रकाश मुमुक्षुरवै शरणमहं प्रपद्ये। As we do Gita Dhyan, meditate on Bhagavan Shri Krishna. ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणी भगवती मष्टादशाध्यायिनी अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवत् गीते भवद्वेषिणी। नमोऽस्तु ते व्यासविशालबुद्धे पुनरविन्दयतपत्रनेत येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्ण प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमय प्रदीपः। प्रपन्न पारिजाताय भूतवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतगुहे नमः। सर्वोपनिषदो गावो दुग्धारूपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्स सुधीर भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतम् वसुदेवसुतं देव कंसचारुमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगत् भीष्म द्रोण तथा जयद्रथ जला गांधार नीलो पला शल्य ग्रामती कृपेण वाणी कर्णेन वेलाकुला अश्वत्थाम विकर्ण घोर मकरा दुर्योधना वर्तिनी सोक्तीना खलु पांडव रण नदी कैवर्तना केशव पाराशर्य पचार सरोज ममल गीतार्थ गंधोत्कटम नानाख्यान केसरम हरि कथा संबोधनाबोधितम् लोके सज्जन षट्पदैर्दारः ते पीयमानम् मुदा भूयात् भारत पंकजं कलिमलं प्रध्वंसिना श्रेयसे मूकं करोति वाचा पंकुलं गयते गिरिम् यत् कृपातमहं वंदे परमानंद माधवम् यम् ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्रुतमरुतस्तुवन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदसामपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्त्यं सामगा ज्ञानावस्थतर्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्त्यं योगिनो यस्यान्तं न विरुसुरासुरगणा देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः बोले वृंदावन बिहारी लाल की राधा रानी की जय गीता माता की आदरणीय पूजनीय पंत जी भक्त वृंद प्रिय सज्जनों महानुभाव मोस्ट वर्शिपफुल पंत जी डिवोटीज ऑफ द सुप्रीम लॉर्ड द डिवाइन सर्विस फर्स्ट लेट मी से राधे राधे टू ईच एंड एवरीवन एंड माय प्रणाम एंड हम्बलेस्ट प्रोसेशन टू ईच एंड एवरीवन ऑफ यू As customary, we chant the divine name of the Lord for a few minutes. So we tune our mind, get our mind in the right attitude, in the right atmosphere, and then we listen to Katha. Shri Radhe Radhe गोविंद राधे श्री राधे राधे गोविंद
Oh,
Close attention is to try to be very attentive listen very carefully. As was mentioned before, on Tuesday, the 14th December, a very special day, auspicious day, we'll be celebrating Gita Jayanti, birthday of Gita, the parents of the Gita. Gita is beginningless. This Gita didn't just happen 5,000 years ago, or beginningless time, but it appeared again a little more than 5,000 years ago. And so to commemorate that wonderful occasion, that most blessed occasion, this Gita is spread throughout the world in so many different languages, so many people benefit. Not only Hindus, but throughout the world. People read Gita, have given commentary, utilize the Gita. Every religion and all over the world. So to commemorate that most wonderful occasion, during the short visit of mine, all my discourses will be based on Gita, as we've been doing so far. This is the fourth session. We have been listening so far that both the Kauravas and the Pandavas are assembled on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Dharmakshetra, Kurukshetra. Samaveta Yutsava. For the reason of fighting for war, they have assembled there. On one side, the Kauravas, led by Duryodhan, his 199 brothers, all sons of Dhritarashtra. On the other side, the Pandavas, sons of Pandu. They are cousins. But as everything else with greed, desire, greed, so much that Duryodhan refused to return, which was rightfully theirs, to the Pandavas, to the point that he said, I will not even give you land equal to even the hair of a needle. So this war has been fought to rightfully reclaim what is theirs, righteous war. Everyone has blown their shank on both sides, starting with Bhishma Pitamaha, the grandsire, to signal the start of the war. Arjun tells Sri Krishna, he commands Sri Krishna, because Sri Krishna is a charioteer, and he is the passenger, the master. Please, not please, take, hey, Krishna, take, sthapayat. Take my chariot and place it in the middle. Why? Nirekshami. I want to see. I want to see who I'm fighting with. Yodhu kamana. Who's come with the desire to fight with. Sri Krishna agreed and took the chariot. Arjuna sees. What does he see? He sees Bhishma Pitamaha, the grandsire. He sees his guru, Dronacharya, elders, his relatives, his cousins. And Arjuna becomes faint-hearted. He loses courage. His bow, the Gandhi, falls on his hand. The skin is burning like fire, and his mind is full of confusion. He's trembling, he can't even stand steady. In that condition, he throws down the bow and arrow, sits down on the seat of the chariot and says, Krishna, I'm not going to fight. Why? My elders, teachers, gurus, relatives are going to die in this war. Women will become widows. The men, having died, they will become characterless. Children will be born bastards. So many bad actions, and I will be the consequence of all of that. The reason for this bad action, I will go to hell. Then he says, Karpandya dosho pahatasva bhava prichhaditvam dharma samurha cheta yache yasya nishitam bruhitame shishyastehaṁ shādhimāṁ tvā prapannam. He then says to Sri Krishna, Hey Krishna, please guide me, I'm begging you, for I'm unable to decide on the right course of action due to the extreme bewilderment of my mind. I seek your guidance as your fully surrendered disciple. In other words, you are my guru and I am your fully surrendered disciple. Prapanna shish. I went in detail about panna and prapanna last night. And Arjuna is saying, you are my guru. I come to you as a disciple. He didn't say, I want to advise me because you're my friend. He was a very close friend of Sri Krishna, his Sakha. And because he was always so his cousin, his aunt's son. So he could have said that you're my cousin or you're my friend. No, he said, you're my guru. And this morning I went in detail about guru. Why we need a guru? Who is a guru? It's important to understand. Go into detail. So, Sri Krishna says, okay, you've made me guru. You're my disciple, Shishya. Listen now. Arjuna, if you don't fight this battle, it's a bad action. Hurt, kaat. Arjuna was confused. Bad action. This doesn't make any sense, Guruji. Gadha, you fool. If everything the Guru says, the disciple understands, then why have Guru-disciple relationship? Why do we need a Guru? I told you this morning, because we don't know. We need someone to be a Guru to give us true knowledge. Guru bin hoi ki gyan. The true knowledge of who am I. That I am not the body, I am the soul, the Atma. The true knowledge of what is my aim in life, my ultimate aim. What is birth, what is death, what takes birth, what dies. Who is God, who is Sri Krishna, why should I want to know God, etc. All this knowledge, Guru gives. Not lecture. Yeah, he gives lecture, but he makes it sit in the intellect. We have heard lectures uncountable times. We have read these books uncountable times, from beginningless time. But we didn't get knowledge. Guru gives knowledge. True. I went into details. After all, how can not fighting a battle be bad? How not fighting a war, how can it be bad? Yes. Those words that are very subtle are not understood by the general public. For example, let's suppose that some scholars were brought together and they were told that in history, one man told his relative, kill all those people, sab ko maar do. But the relative said, no, I don't want to kill. And besides, I have no desire for kingdom. But the man argued with the relative, and the relative ended up killing millions of people. Oh my God. That was a very bad man. Afterwards, you say, The man was God, Shri Krishna, and the relative was Arjuna, Mahapurusha, saint. Then the scholars would say, okay, it's okay. Because whatever God does, no one can understand. So now try to understand. Shri Krishna says, Arjuna, if you do not fight this war, it's a bad action for which you will have to go to hell, Narak. Arjuna said, Krishna, how can not fighting the war be a bad action? If I do something wrong, then send me to hell, by all means. But when I'm not doing anything, I'm not even fighting, why are you sending me to hell? Shri Krishna says, not fighting the war is also an action. Ye bhi karma hai. What kind of riddle is this? Yes. Not fighting the war is also an action, Arjuna, because you are Kshatri. You are Kshatri, a member of the warrior class, and so it's your duty, your dharma, to fight the war. Do not perform your duty as a Kshatri, you will go to hell. Arjuna said, okay, if I don't fight the war, it's a bad action for which a dharmic action for which I will go to hell, being a Kshatri. What is the result of fighting the war? Agar main yudh karunga, Bhagwan says, Hato va prapsasi swargam, jitva va bhokshase mahi. Chapter 2, verse 37, Gita. Arjuna, if you die in a war, two things can happen. Either you die, or you are victorious. You win. So, Hatova, if you die, prapsi swargam, you will attain heaven. If as a kshatri, this is your dharma, and you fight in a righteous battle and you die while fighting that battle, the result, the reward is swargam, heaven. You will go to heaven. On the other hand, if you are victorious, you will become king of the world. Dono hath mein laddu. Either way, you emerge a winner. I just said, take it, take it. Okay, okay. Now tell me something, Krishna. Will I get true happiness in heaven, in that place called heaven, Swarg? Bhagavan Krishna says, Tetam bhuktva swargalokam vishalam kshine punye martyalokam vishanti evam tai dharmanupapanna gatakatam kama kama labhante. Chapter 9, verse 21, Gita. Shri Krishna is saying, is explaining to Arjuna, when we perform righteous action, dharmic action, according to the rules and regulations of the Vedas, not what we think is good. Ved anusar, according to the Vedas. The Vedas. Very strict rules and regulation. 80,000 mantras, karma kaan. Dharma, duty. Varn ashram dharma. Varn ashram. Varn, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaish, Shudra. Varn, char varn, four varnas. Ashram, Brahmacharya, Grihasthi, Vanaprasthi, Sannyas. Four ashram, four stages of life. Very difficult. In other words, what a Brahman is supposed to do, what a Kshatriya is supposed to do, what a Vaishya is supposed to do, what a Shudra is supposed to do. And in a Brahman, what a Brahmachari Brahman is supposed to do, what a Grihasthi Brahman is supposed to do, what a Vanaprasthi Brahman is supposed to do, what a Sannyasi Brahman is supposed to do. Same for Kshatriya, same for Vanaprasthi, same for Shudra. In Kali Yuga, these things cannot be done. very difficult in the Ramayana.
Kalpasundaji says to Guruji in the Kalyug Mahima of the Ramayana, कलियुग जो
section in the Ramayana called Kalyug Mahima. The Kalpasundari ji relates to Garuji what happens in Kalyug. He said, in the age of Kalyug, Kalyug yoga na jagya jnana, you cannot do yoga. I mentioned last night, yoga doesn't mean yoga. Yoga means yam, niyam, asan, pranayam, pratyahar, dharana, dhyan, samadhi. Impossible. Gyan, impossible. So difficult. Kahatas kathin samujhat kathin sadhan kathin vivek. Kahat kathin. To talk about a path of gyan, very difficult. Samujhatta, to understand, more difficult. And to do, forget it. Kshurasya dhara nishita duratyaya. Kathopanishad, the Vedas say, the path of gyan is like walking on the sharp edge of a sword. In the same Gita, in chapter 12, Arjunakshi Krishna, those who worship the formless absolute Brahman, the formless aspect of Sri Krishna, and those who worship him with the form, which is greater? Sabse bara kaun hai, sabse shreshth. Bhagwan said both will attain. Whoever does bhakti, whether it's to be with a form or formless. But for the individual with a body, we have a body. To meditate on something without a body is not only difficult, impossible. For us who have body, it's so difficult. Impossible. So much difficult. Yajna, dharma. There are so many rules and regulations. Dharma sampadyate shat bhi Radharmastu vipariyaya. Shadabhi, there are six conditions. Six. To fulfill and perform in dharma, and all impossible in Kali. Anyhow, if someone can do, fulfill all these conditions, six. Sthan. Mantra, dravya, samagri, dravya,
कर्ता, जजमान,
all have rules and regulations. A little mistake, a slight mistake in the pronunciation of a mantra, in Ved, there's something called swar. In Ved mantra, swar, swar. Swar doesn't mean letter, swar means intonation. In Ved mantra, there's something called swar. The voice has to be intonated. Ah, ah, swar. And if there's a slight mistake, instead of going up, the voice goes down, the whole meaning changes. The letter is the same. Once a rakshas, Trishta, caught hold of some rishis and munis and forced them to perform a yajna, to kill Indra. He wanted to kill Indra, the king of the devatas, the god of rain. And in that yajna, there was a mantra. Indra Shaturvivardhasva. Let Indra be destroyed. Now, that rakshas didn't know Sanskrit. And the rishis and munis, they were being forced to perform this yajna, and they were also worshipping Indra. So they changed one swar. The words remain the same, the letters. Indra Shaturvivardhasva. They change it. Indra Shaturvivardhasva. It sounds the same, right? But in one, the intonation went up, and the other went down, and the whole meaning changed. And now, the meaning was now, let Indra be victorious, and the Rakshas was killed. This katha is in Ved, is in Devi Bhagavat. While dying, the Indra, that Rakshas said, "Hey Vishnu, this is an injustice. I perform a yajna for Indra to be killed and I am killed." Bhagavan says, "Bhaiya, your Purohits, they made a mistake in the mantra. So they should be punished? No, no. The judgment gets punishment. So come so many punishments. Difficult. And an example. So let's look at the different stages. Let's suppose in this Kali Yuga, we're supposed to live for 100 years. Length of its lifespan. Till 25 years of age, you are supposed to be in Brahmachari Ashram. Brahmachari. Brahmachari doesn't mean student. Brahmachari means celibacy. You have to be celibate in words, thoughts, and deeds. Thoughts! The Guru says, don't even look at the picture of a woman. No sensual thought should come in the mind. Today, little children are looking at computer and they're guessing all kinds of craziness and doing all kinds of craziness. Little children. Where's the Brahmachari? Huh? A lot of people think Brahmachari means student, so you can do all the wrong things. That's not Brahmachari. Bhishma Pitamaha was Akhanda Brahmachari. He took a vow. Entire life, he was so powerful because of that. Akhanda Brahmachari. I will never get married. Nor allow any sensual thought to come in my mind. At 25 years of age, the Guru says, okay, go and get married. Grihastashram. Till 25 years of age, I should not look even at the photo. And now get married. Okay, Guru's Agya, instruction, you get married.
You get married, now you enter into householder's life. Here's ashram. You have children, you have property, etc. At 50 years of age, the guru comes. Hey, whose house is this? My Guruji. Whose children? Mine. Whose bank balance? Mine. Umurka? Mine. Hey, nothing belongs to you. Everything belongs to God. Tatai karam dhikari sadi dunya. Everything belongs to God. We are custodians of His property. We are beggars. Leave everything. Leave the house, the muruka, leave the children, the bank balance. Leave everything. The land. Go in the forest. Van. Vanaprastha. Van means forest. You are the wife. Go in the forest and live. Who? Go in the forest. Leave my house, my muruka. The children, the bank balance. Tell me who in Kaliyuga is going to do that. Tell me. Find somebody. At 75 years of age, the guru comes again. Hey, who is that? My husband. Who is that? My wife. Hey, you're the soul, the atma. The soul, atma has no husband and wife. You go that way, you go that way. Sannyas ashram. Complete renunciation. And nowadays, people are renewing their vows at 80 years. Getting married again. You're supposed to be in sannyas ashram. And you enjoy married life. So who can perform dharma? That's why it says in Kali Yuga impossible. Many examples, I can go whole night. As to why it's impossible. It's so difficult. Anyhow, if one can fulfill all the rules and regulations, you acquire something called punya. Punya. Spiritual merits. Which will give you as to how long you will go in heaven. Punya. How long you will go and which heaven? There are many heavenly regions. And how long you will stay for. But when you go there, Sri Krishna says, after having performed dharma, if you can, and you acquire punya, you will go to heaven. But while enjoying the vast pleasures of heaven, what happens? Kshine punya. That punya starts destroying, which is so difficult to acquire, almost impossible in Kali Yuga. As you enjoy, it starts destroying. And one day it's going to finish, zero. And then what will happen? Martyalokam vishanti, you'll be kicked out of heaven. Because karma, because your punya has become zero. Look, we think, you know, as Hindus, we have no idea what this place called heaven is or what happens there. Other religion talks about heaven, Islam, Christianity, etc., as a reward for being a good person. But Sanatan Dharma doesn't tell us about heaven. It tells us, but it tells us that's not the aim of life. Yet we call ourselves Hindus, and very few people understand or know what this place called heaven is or what happens there. We want. We want in the Ramayana. Uttarakhand of Ramayana, Bhagwan Sri Ram is warning us, he's warning the residents of Ayodhya about heaven. Bhagwan Sri Ram says, Ehita Nakara Pala Vishaya Na Bhai, Swargam, swargam, ant dukhdai.
After glorifying the human body, bari bhagya manusha tan paava, sura love is at the Granth Nigava. That it is the greatest fortune for the soul to acquire birth in the human form, that even devatas, sur means devata, Indra, the king of heaven, god of rain, Agni, the god of fire, Vayu, the god of wind, Kubera, the god of wealth, etc. We pray to devatas because we want to go to heaven. Yati devrata devan. Chapter 9, verse 25. Those who pray to devatas will go to heaven, will become devatas. So Krishna says it in Gita. But those same devatas who are in heaven where we want to go, they are praying to get what? What we have. This human body. It means this is greater. If they are praying for it, Adhika. So Bhagavan Sri Ram is saying, this human body which is so valuable, deva dullab, that even devatas are begging and praying and can't get it, wasn't given to you to just enjoy sensual pleasures, enjoy the senses. Vishayana bhai, nor was it given to go to heaven, swarga huswap. Why? Because there is no happiness, true happiness in heaven. Swarg. Swarg means non-existent, very small. And the worst part, ant dukhadai. After you go to heaven, you are going to suffer. You'll be thrown out and you're going to suffer. Look, there are many, many heavenly regions. A very systematic evaluation of the happiness in each heavenly region is given in the Vedas, Taittiriya Upanishad, chapter 2, verse 8. Saisha nandasya mimansa bhavati yuvasya sadhu yuvadhyayaka ashishto dharishto balishto tasyam prithvi sarva vittasya purnasya sa eko manusha ananda teshata manusha ananda sa eko manusha gandharvana mananda teshata manusha gandharvana mananda sa eko deva gandharvana mananda teshata deva gandharvana mananda sa ekah pitrinam chiraloka lokana mananda teshatam pitrinam chiraloka lokana mananda sa ek ajan janam devana mananda teshatam ajan janam devana mananda sa ekah karma devanam devana mananda teshatam karma devanam devana mananda sa eko devana mananda teshatam devana mananda sa ek indasya ananda देशतम इंद्रस्यानंदा स एको बृहस्पतिरानंदा देशतम बृहस्पतिरानंदा स एक प्रजापतिरानंदा देशतम प्रजापतिरानंदा स एको ब्रह्मनानंद तैत्तिरीय उपनिषद चैप्टर 2 वर्स 8 सेकंड वल्लिका 8 वाक. What this means? Very long explanation. Understand. Supposing there's a young man in the prime of his youth, most virtuous, most learned, most strongly built, most energetic. In Hindi, anyone who has something in excess, the word van is put behind. Van. Dhanavan means very rich. Balavan, very powerful. Buddhivan, very knowledgeable. So all the van you can open it. He has it. Now, supposing the rule of the entire world, filled with all the wealth and opulence, were to be given to this young person, this young man. He's made the king. Long ago,
The whole world was ruled by one king. Ambarish, Prahlad, Dhruv, etc. The whole was in Satyu. The whole world was ruled. And later on in this Kalyu, there were 200 countries. Every country had their own king, etc. Nowadays there's hardly maybe one, two in some little place somewhere. We have president, prime ministers, etc. But no king anymore. If they are, there's no power. But the king, one king for the whole world. And all the subjects are favorable, they love him. Not everybody loves the king, not everybody loves the prime minister, the president. How many people want to kill him? So he's the king of the whole world with all the wealth and opulence, and all the subjects love him. Such a king would consider to be the happiest man in the world. The happiness of such a king, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of one Madhav Gandharva. This is the first heavenly happiness. There are some entities called Gandharva. They sing, dance, they're musicians. Not like in this world. Thousands of times more. No one can sing like Gandharvas, no one can dance like them, etc. So Manav Gandharva. The happiness of one Manav Gandharva multiplied hundreds of times is equal to the happiness of one Dev Gandharva, a little bit higher. The happiness of one Dev Gandharva multiplied hundreds of times is equal to the happiness of one of the manes of the abode of the Pitris, one of the Pitris. There's an abode called Pitrilok, where the Pitris, our ancestors, reside, those who perform good action. Pitris. The happiness of one of the Pitris, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of one Ajanaj Dev, one who is born in heaven as a Devata. The happiness of one Ajanaj Dev, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of one Karmadev. The happiness of one Karmadev, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of one Devata, celestial god. Agni, the god of fire. Vayu, the god of wind, etc. Varun, the god of water. The happiness of one Devata, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of Indra, the king of heaven. Raja. The happiness of Indra, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of Brihaspati, the guru of the Devatas. The happiness of Brihaspati, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of Prajapati. The happiness of Prajapati, multiplied hundreds of times, is equal to the happiness of Brahma, the creator. Satyaloka. There are many heavenly happiness, but there are seven heavenly regions. Seven. Bhu, Bhuva, Swa, Maha, Jana, Tapa, Satya. The highest Satya Loka, the abode of Brahma. But there is no happiness even in the abode of Brahma. True happiness. Look, there is no happiness in this material world. In any personal object. People think I found happiness. Those who like sweet, when I eat the ice cream, I got happiness. Really? You eat ice cream, you get happiness? Okay. Take another ice cream. Take a third ice cream. Fourth ice cream. Sixth ice cream. Please don't give me any more ice cream. Why? I will vomit. You should keep eating if you get happiness. So in time that happiness comes to an end, and we even start experiencing sorrow. The same thing that gives you happiness in the world ends up giving you sorrow. So where is the happiness? happiness means, there's a definition for happiness. Yogai bhuma tat sukham bhumai vasukham Chandogya Upanishad. The Vedas are defining what happiness is. That which is infinite, unmeasurable, eternal, beginningless, is called sukh or happiness. Once attained, it is possessed forever. You will never become separate from it ever again. You will never experience sorrow ever again. Have we attained or experienced such a thing? Something giving you happiness now, and next moment you sad. So where is the happiness? That's our delusion, that's all. So there is no happiness in the world, zero. Now, if many of you have done maths, even though you're not good in mathematics, many of us hate mathematics, but even if you're not good, you would know that when you multiply anything by zero, what do you get? 100 multiplied by 0, 0. 1000 multiplied by 0, 0. Million multiplied by 0, 0. Trillion multiplied by 0, 0. No matter how many times you multiply by 0, you will get 0. And that's all the happiness of heaven, multiplying by 0. Hundreds of times, 100, and you just keep multiplying. So logically, there's also no happiness. Sri Krishna says, Ah, Brahma Bhuvana Loka Punaravartino Juna Mam Pitit Kaunteya Punarjanmana Vidyate. Gita chapter 8 verse 16. Arjun, all these heavenly regions, from the highest one, Satyalok, the abode of Brahma, the creator, they're all destructible. There's a time limit. And only upon attaining Sri Krishna, we do not come back in this material world. That's the true happiness. So there's nothing, there's no happiness. Zero. Not only that. The Vedas say, Avidyaya mantare vartamana Swayam dhira panditam manyamana Janghanyamana pariyanti murha Andhe naivanyamana yathandha. Mundaka Upanishad, first Mundaka, second Kanda, eighth mantra. The Veda says those people who don't understand the true import of the scriptures, the Vedas, the Gita, etc., and they preach and tell heaven as the aim of life and to attain happiness in the world and in heaven, etc., they are blind. Andha. And those who follow them, they are also blind. It's a case of blind leading the blind. If a blind person holds the hand of another blind person and says, I'm taking you to Shabwanas, from Freeport, what's going to happen? They will die. Few steps. Ishta purtam mandamana varishtam nanya chheyo vedayante pramudha Nākasya prishtete sukhitena bhūtimam lokam hi naptram vāvishanti. Mundaka Upanishad, first Mundaka, second Kanda, tenth mantra. The Vedas say, the same Vedas tell us what to do if we want to go to heaven, and the same way tells us that those people who want to go to heaven, their desires to go to heaven, and they perform action to go to heaven, they're not only ordinary fools, but the greatest fools. Murha, in Sanskrit, in Hindi, murk, in English, fool, stupid. And in Sanskrit, when we add the prefix pra before a word, it means the greatest. Pra murha, greatest fool. Okay. Many people, when our near and dear ones have died, people send up card. My father has gone to heaven, swargabas ho gaya. My mummy has gone to heaven, swargabasi. In other words, my mummy and daddy were the greatest fool. Because we don't understand that heaven is not a nice place to go. The aim is not heaven. We have been to heaven uncountable times.
uncountable time we have become devatas. We have performed righteous action. We have been to heaven. And we have to come back right here. Karma gets destroyed. The Vedas, that Ved mantra I told you from Mundak Upanishad, first Mundak, second content mantra. After your karma is destroyed, what happens? And you're thrown out of heaven. Heena taram bhavishanti. Heen. Yoni me patak jayega. You'll be thrown into lower forms of life. You see, karma has been destroyed. We have zero. All the punya has been used up in heaven to enjoy. Have a good time. Everyday carnival party. And you use it up. Finish. All the money in the bank, finish. And you go back to the bank and you say to the cashier, you write a check, a withdrawal slip, $10,000. The bank man, the bank clerk says, hey, you have no money in the bank. No money? I had $1 million in this bank. Yes, sir. Look the balance. You took all this money, you enjoy, you had a good time. Zero. You mean I'm a beggar? Yes, sir. And so karma has become zero. We have to start all over again. We'll be thrown into the womb of dog, cat, donkey, worm. So low. This is what Bhagavan Shri Ram means in the Ramayana. You see, if you don't know philosophy, you don't know Ved, etc., then you would not understand what Shri Ram means when he says, Ant Dukhadai. After you go to heaven, you're going to suffer. How are you going to understand? Because one day you're a devata, celestial god, next day you're in a worm, the yoni of a worm, the body of a worm, a grass, a tree, a dog, stray dog, people pelting you with stones, beating you with sticks. We can't even think about the kind of suffering we have. We have been through that uncountable times and we'll go back there. If we don't do bhakti, we do not understand what we have to do. What is the reason for human life? Why we have been given human birth? Why this human birth is so valuable? And what we are supposed to do with it, having done. Then we have to go back all and rotate in that 8.4 million forms of life. In all the hells. Kumbhi pa, Baitarani ho. Yes, all these narak. Just hearing about them, you will run, you will start screaming. The kind of suffering. You will be screaming and bawling, nobody will be there to help you. You had a good time in the world, acha, have a good time here too. Willy, willy, and jump, jump, and no, have a good time here too. We have a golden opportunity. So there's no happiness. Understand tonight, the aim of life is not heaven. We have been there uncountable times. Bhagavan Shri Ram is making it very clear. He's warning us, this human body was not given to you to go to heaven. They in heaven are praying for this. The devatas. Durlabham manusham janma prathyate tirashaira pi narapuram. The devatas are praying to Shri Krishna. Hey Shri Krishna, we are begging you, please give us birth in the human form. We don't want heaven. We, because of ignorance, because we do not know where to find happiness, we keep looking for it in the wrong place. Why? And what we're supposed to do? We'll hear tomorrow about that. Let's go bhajan. And then we'll go further. In the books you have, turn to page 25 in the booklets.
Radhe, Radhe. Govinda bhaj Radhe Radhe Govinda Radhe Radhe Govinda
lotus feet of Bhagwan Shri Radha and Krishna.
Bhaju Mangal Charan Arvinda Radhe Radhe Govinda.
Atma, Atma, Mati, 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 Radhe, Radhe. It's our fundamental nature to love Him.
हरे ही साक्षात भगवान शरीरिना मात्मा जशाना मिवतो यमीत सिता
भागवत महापुराण 5th कांटो 18th चैप्टर 13th वर्स जस्ट समवन कैचेस अ फिश एंड ब्रिंग्स इन दैट फिश ऑन ड्राई लैंड द फिश विल स्टार्ट फ्लॉपिंग एंड बीटिंग इटसेल्फ and desperately struggles to return to water, its natural abode. In the same way, we the individual souls, without Sri Krishna, feels restless without Him. We feel incomplete, incomplete.
Krishna me nama vehitvam atmanam akhilatma jagatvitaya sopyatra dehiva bhati mayaya
10th canto, 14th chapter, 55th verse. Sri Krishna is the soul of all souls. Now, it's a natural law that all parts, all fraction has a natural love for the whole and wants to become one with it. It's natural law. All rivers naturally flow to the ocean, being a fraction of the ocean. If you look at the flame of a fire, it naturally rises upward because it's a fraction of the sun. In the same way, we the individual souls, being eternal fractions of Sri Krishna, naturally love and want only Sri Krishna.
ईश्वर अंश जीव अविनाशी चेतन अमर सहज शुद्ध
So it means we naturally love and want only God. This is why Valmiki ji says in the Valmiki Ramayana, Loke nahi sa vidyeta yo nara mamanu brata. Valmiki Ramayana. Valmiki ji says, it is impossible to find an individual soul that does not truly love and want God. Sounds strange? Because you know there are people who believe in God, love God, and there are people who don't believe in God. They're atheist, nasty. They will even try to stop others from taking God's name. So what does Valmiki is telling us a lie? Are the saints lying to us? Tulsidas he also says in the Ramayana,
Thank you. सांस को जीव जन को जग मारा को जीव जन को जग मारा
And he says to all of them, Shri Ram, God is as dear as life. It means we love God, we want God, we can't help it. It's our nature. And who is God? What is God? In the Taittiriya Upanishad, the Vedas are the most important, the highest authority. And the most important section of Vedas are called Upanishad. So there are main Upanishads. One of them is Taittiriya Upanishad. In the third chapter, there's a katha, a narration. Viguravai Varuni Varnam Pitaram Upasasar. There was a rishi by the name of Bhrigu. He was the son of Varun. Varun was a Brahma Jnani, know of God. Not Atma Jnani, self-realized, God-realized. So the question came in Bhrigu's mind, who is God? What is God? What is this thing called Bhagavan, Paramatma, Supreme Power, Ishwar, Khuda, God? Everyone has a question. Who should I ask? You should have to ask Guru, who to make Guru. So Bhrigu thought, since my father is worthy of being Guru, I told you the condition this morning. Jnaninaha Tattvadarshina. Sri Krishna makes it clear in Gita, chapter 4, verse 34. Who is Guru? Two things qualifies him to be Guru. Number one, Jnaninaha. He has knowledge of all the scriptures, all the Vedas, all the complete knowledge. Plus, he is able to remove our doubts. Yam. But even more important, Tattvadarshinaha. He has seen God, attained God. Brahma Gyan. The divine knowledge of God. What should you do if you find such a person? Tadvirpranipatena pariprasnena sevaya. Upadikshati te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinaha. Chapter 4, verse 34. If you are so fortunate, Sri Krishna is saying to Arjuna in the Gita class, to find that Guru, the true Guru, jnaninaha tattva darshinaha, what should you do? Number one, tadvir pranipatena. Completely surrender to him. Completely surrender. I went in detail about surrender. Surrender the mind, intellect. Number two, pariprasnena, ask question. We are told you have to ask. But not to see how much a person knows. Many times we ask questions because we read a little bit here, read a little bit there, and we want to show off how much we know. Or we want to have an argument. We want to show that person that he doesn't know. No, no, no. When you approach a spiritual master, you have to approach with an inquisitive mind, not a doubtful one, a desire to know that I don't know.
This is why Shri Krishna did not only say Prashna, he said Pariprashnena. Asked with an inquisitive mind. And Sevaya, do his Seva, serve him. He will give you the knowledge of God. So Bhikkhu taught, my father is qualified, he's Brahmagyani, so he made his father Guru. And then he said, Adhihi Bhagavo Brahmeti. Who is God? What is God? Oh Guruji, what is this thing called Bhagavan, Brahma, God? Varun replied and said, Yato vayamani bhutani jata yena jatani jivati yat prayantyam isam vishanti tat vijigyasasa tam brah tat brahmeti. Taittiriya Upanishad chapter 3 verse 1, all the mantras are true. Varun replied and said, Shishya, Prabhu, that from which all beings are born, that by which they are sustained, they live, they are sustained, and that into which they merge upon death, that is God. You understand, Prabhu? Prabhu was totally confused. So the Guru said, okay, go and do sadhana. I will help. Do sadhana. So Bhrigu went and did sadhana. And I'm not going to go in detail, time wouldn't allow, some other time. He made many discoveries. First, he discovered one grain of food as the ultimate reality known as Brahm. He went and said, Guruji, food is God. Guru said, now, go back and do more tapasya. He went and this time he discovered Pran, the life force, is the ultimate reality known as Brahm. He went and said, Guruji, Prano Brahmeti Vijana. Guru said, now, wrong. Go and do more sadhana. He went and continued this time, Mano Brahmeti Vijana. He discovered the mind is ultimate reality known as Brahm. Guru said, now, you're wrong. Go do more sadhana. He went. This time he discovered Vijnanam Brahmeti Vijanat. The soul is the ultimate reality known as Brahm. He went to the Guru. Guru said, no, you're still wrong. Do more sadhana. He continued. This time he discovered Anando Brahmeti Vijanat. Ananda Deva Karvimani Bhutani Jayanti. Anandina Jatani Jeevanti. Anandam Prayantya Vivisanti. Taittiriya Upanishad chapter 3 verse 6. Ananda bliss. Happiness is the ultimate reality known as Brahm, God. From bliss alone, the entire universe comes into being. Bliss is but that by which we are sustained, and bliss is that into which we merge upon death. When he said that, Guru smiled. Yes, now you understand. So Bhrigu, what did Bhrigu discover? Bhrigu discovered that God was Anand, bliss, happiness. In other words, whenever we say happiness, bliss, or we say Shri Krishna, God, they are two names for one and the same entity. God is happiness and happiness is God. So because we are eternal parts, fraction of Shri Krishna, God, it means we all love and want only God. And because Shri Krishna is happiness, that's why we all want only happiness. But because of ignorance, because we have forgotten who we are, that I am the soul, the atma, we identify with the physical body. From beginningless time, we have been searching in the wrong place. We have been searching in the material world, in material person, material objects, and that's why we keep rotating in the 8.4 million forms of life. First to begin, we have to realize that knowledge has to come. I am the soul, the atma, I am not the body. That knowledge, first knowledge. Then we will stop looking in the wrong direction. This knowledge, as I said, this comes when we associate with the true guru, the true saint. then we are doing the satsang. When you associate with a true saint, something happens. Our attachment for the material world from beginningless time, which we could not change by ourselves, when we associate with a true saint, automatically our attachment for the world will start decreasing and our attachment, our love for God will start increasing. Then we are doing satsang. The real satsang. This is what happens when you associate with a true saint. Automatically it's going to happen. So, we all want only happiness. Be in a fraction of that happiness. The knowledge has to come. Most important that we are the soul, the Atma. And what does Sri Krishna have to say about the soul, the Atma? We will hear in the next discourse. Bhole Vrindavan Bihari Lal Ki Jai. Srimad Sadguru Sarkar Ki Jai. Bhole Radha Rani Ki Jai. Gita Mata Ki Jai. Jai Jai Shri Radhe. Jai Jai Shri Radhe. Jai Jai.